Hi guys, my name is Marissa and I am a grade 12 student at Centennial CDI, and today I'm going to be talking a little bit about the scarcity of youth, and in particular the scarcity of all you guys in the audience today. Now you might be thinking, Marissa, you are crazy. There are almost 8 billion people on this earth. How am I scarce? How is there a scarce amount of me? Well, don't believe me, I grew up in New York City, so I know everything there is to know about overpopulation. I mean, I used to live near this one high school, and they named this one particular hall in this high school after a street on Times Square, and that was 42nd Street. And in this hall, you were bound to bump shoulders with as someone in the hall, so you might as well have just stood there in the middle, waited for the bell to ring, and then proceeded to your class. But earlier this year, I had the opportunity to sit down and speak with the CEO of Cleveland Clinic Canada. Wow, that's a tongue twister trying to say that. But so Cleveland Clinic is a teaching hospital, an international teaching hospital. And what Mike Kessel had to share with me, I found was absolutely inspiring. And so, as youth, never forget the value of scarcity. We are all individual in our own way, and so we need to find a way to draw on our individuality and promote that and really make our own that individuality that we have. And I don't know if you guys know what basic economic principles, but he touched on the value of scarcity. And the value of scarcity is basically, if you have a product that's scarce or there's a shortage in supply, immediately or generally you'll know that the demand for it will spike up as well as the price for it will spike up. And if you still are sitting there thinking, Marissa, I do not get economics, you're gonna have to break this down for me. Do not worry, I'll put it into perspective for you. So raise your hand if you know or have seen these shoes within the past few years. All right, that's great to hear. I see some hands down. I'm sorry, I have absolutely nothing to say to you. I'm joking, don't worry. These are actually Kanye West's Yeezy Boosts. Now, what's so interesting about these is that, let's take the Yeezy Boost 750s for an example. These were named the most valued sneaker of 2015. And the reason for that is because of the millions of people that were dying to get their hands on these sneakers, only 9,000 were released. So that's what's causing all these people to line up at the break of dawn just to get their hands on these sneakers. And really, the reason for that, you're probably thinking, that's crazy, why would anybody line up for just to get their hand on a pair of sneakers? Well, it's exactly what Mike touched on, and it's the value of scarcity. Really, what you need to learn, or what you need to think about as youth is, how do I get these employers, how do I get these universities to start lining up for me, just as these people have lined up for the Yeezy Boost? And it just comes from the value of scarcity. You need to find your scarce asset and own it. You need to find your scarce asset and develop what makes you different in comparison to anyone else. And so, you're probably sitting there thinking, Marissa, I don't know what the heck you're talking about. How do I find my scarce asset? And so I have a little demonstration for you guys. So I placed one piece of paper under one of your seats. If that special person is you, may please raise your hand. All right, you in the audience, I am happy to inform you that you win absolutely nothing. But the main purpose of that activity was to show you, I mean, how else would you have known that a piece of paper was or wasn't under your seat without dropping your head down below your seat and checking? And so when you ask me, how am I supposed to know what my scarce asset is? How am I supposed to find it? My answer to you is, how do you know unless you try? And so before I go into how I live up to this whole mantra of trying and doing, let me start talking about where I begin. Because the truth is, we all start from different, we have different beginnings, we start from different places. And for me, I'd like to tell you a little story about my cousin, Jenny. I'm joking, that's actually grade 5 Marissa Liu. I know, very embarrassing. But the purpose is to show you that I grew up a very incredibly shy child. There's one story of me and my mother. She probably knows this. She's a mom right now. But I used to hide under my mom's skirt and just sit between her legs because I just could not stand being in the presence of other people, having attention from people I wasn't even familiar with. And so just imagine yourself as a mother, and I know that might be hard for some of you in the audience today, but imagine yourself as a mother. You're walking down the streets in New York City and you have this stupid little child in between your legs, I mean, it's not what you sign up for. You sign up to be a mother, not the main actor of March of the Penguins, am I correct? So that's who I was. I was an incredibly shy child, and that's just where I started. Now, before I, now the best and easiest way I can describe how I came to be who I am today, how I am standing in front of you, all of you guys today, not in between my mom's legs, is through volunteerism. And as cliche as it sounds, I stand by it 100%. And the main reason for that is, well, volunteerism was what got me to this, where I am today. And the main stepping stone, to finding my scarce asset and what made me different was actually through Guelph Youth Council. I was involved with Guelph Youth Council throughout all my years of high school. And I started off as that little girl in the corner who didn't really talk, who just showed up for the snacks and the food. But I mean, I'm sorry, Jen, but I wouldn't really join to get those 40 hours of community service over with. But yeah, from there, once we started planning or organizing all these amazing youth events that Guelph Youth Council runs, like Youth League, Music Works, Stage Works, and a multicultural festival tent, I found that I was participating more, I was involving myself more, and from there I took that confidence and I started applying it to other aspects of my life, like school. I started joining so many more clubs, I started joining more organizations, volunteering, and then at that point I had to ask myself, all right, I've learned how to be a leader in my school, a leader in my community, how do I learn to be a young leader in Canada? And so one day, my very good friend Wendy walked up to me and told me about this organization called Global Vision. And Global Vision is essentially a nonprofit organization that sends youth from all over Canada to different countries. And what each individual youth has to do as a trade ambassador is partner with different companies in their community and raise a total of $5,500 in corporate and community sponsorships. And from the partners you gain, you have to represent them as you network with industry professionals and government officials and fulfill whatever mandate it is that they have tasked you with. So for example, I represented the agriculture sector. That meant that I had a few agriculture and agri-food companies that wanted me to network and connect them with distributors and within Hong Kong, China, and Peru. And so what this mission really meant for me was it is not only a mental stepping outside my comfort zone, but also a physical one. Now, I was stepping physically outside of my home into a whole new country I had never been in before. And soon enough, I found that I was leading 35 Canadian youth to China and Peru so that they could fulfill whatever mandate their sponsors had asked them for. And truly, it was just such an amazing experience finding, learning how to represent myself as a Canadian youth, learning how to represent Canada and my companies. And I found that within no time, after all the initiatives I had taken on, I discovered what I love to do, what my unique, scarce asset was. And I was simply just being a leader. And being a leader that not only tries to think innovatively, but also creatively, so that whoever I met, whatever I was doing, it would make a lasting impression. That's what the whole mission was. I mean, our founder, Teddy Clifford, always rambled on about finding our competitive advantage and owning it. And that's exactly what I learned and love to do. So if there was something that I wanted you guys to take away, sorry, zoom through the photos. But yes, these are just photos of the mission, and it was just a truly amazing experience meeting all these people, learning about all their different stories and paths of life. And then we always had a rooftoping session within each city we went to. But yeah, this is just a zoom through of everything, and me asking a few questions, meeting a few business professionals. And so, which brings me to my last and final point. I actually have the voice of my economics teacher yapping away, what are the implications of this talk? Because honestly, after the end of every economics class we have, we always have a TED talk, or we always watch a TED talk. And from there, he always asks us, what are the implications of this talk? And so if I wanted you guys to take away three implications or three things you should at least learn, if you're dozing off getting in the middle of my speech, from what I've talked about, it's this. The first thing is find your passions. And as cliche as it sounds, I know, I get it, or words, but it's super cliche, you've heard it 1,000 times, is this: you don't understand, some of you guys may be working 9-to-5 jobs in your future, but what many of you don't understand is that in doing so, what you're doing is selling your heartbeats, your livelihood, to whatever person you're working for, carrying out, for whatever purpose, carrying out whatever they task you with, for someone else's profit. And from there, you need to understand that if you're gonna sell your heartbeats, your livelihood, at least make it worthwhile, and at least incorporate some of your passion so that you're not draining your life away. You're doing what you love and there's a purpose to it. So that's the first thing. The second thing is volunteer. And I already just gave you my whole spiel about how I came to end up on this stage. So now it's up to you to find what yours is. And I want you guys to really think about each volunteer initiative you take on as a test trial. You know, scientists, they do countless, endless test trials before they can come to an accurate conclusion about their experiment, correct? So that's the same thing you guys have to do. You have to take on each volunteer initiative as a test trial so that you can get one step closer to who you want to be when you grow up, what your scarce asset is, what makes you different and you so unique. And what you'll find in no time is that with each volunteer initiative you take on, the probability of error approaches zero, just like an experiment should. In other words, the more volunteer initiatives you take on, the more certain you will be of your future and the more certain you will be of what your passions are. The last thing is, be different, be scarce. Like I said with the easy boost, there's a reason why so many people climb up in the cold or whatever weather just to get their hands on these shoes that aren't even valued at that much. But what you need to do is get universities and employers to do that same thing for you and not the other way around. Nobody wants to line up for universities waiting for whichever one will accept them first. What you want to do is get them to line up for you, and then I can assure you the stress will be cut in half or even more. And then, honestly, the main purpose of this is just to show you that in whatever you do, make sure that you are being different. You are thinking differently, you are thinking innovatively, and you'll find that in no time, your passions and your scarce asset will pan out for you. And so I just want to close off thanking all of you guys for coming today. You guys have been invited by either Guelph Youth Council or your guidance counselor, whoever it may be, because you are either a leader in your community or a leader in your school. So it reassures me so much that there's so many people on the right path to figuring out what their scarce asset is, what makes them different. But I mean, if you're like me at one point in my life where you just don't know what that is, I assure you, do not worry. Just keep going at it, keep volunteering, and in no time, it'll pan out for you. Just keep doing, and you'll figure it out. So we have an amazing line of speakers for today, and I hope that you take everything they share, every experience that they share, into consideration and learn as much as you can from it. Thank you very much.